Good morning. We're going to start with something very familiar to us this morning, but in a little different order. We're going to start with a time of prayer. We're going to start with some familiar thoughts, but expressed in very different words, as I read from 1 Peter 1, verses 6 and 7, but I'm going to read it from the Living Translation. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though the going is rough for a while down here. These trials are only to test your faith, to see whether or not it is strong and pure. It is being tested as fire tests gold and purifies it, and your faith is far more precious to God than mere gold. So if your faith remains strong after being tried in the test tube of fiery trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day of His return. Tony mentioned last week we've been going through a lot of stuff. I think that was putting it pretty mildly. And a lot of those things we've gone through, a lot of them are still going through. If you took Tony's challenge last Sunday and read through Matthew, when you came to Matthew 8, as I did on Monday morning, verses 23 through 27 say, "And when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by waves. But he was asleep. And they went and woke him, saying, 'Save us, Lord, we are perishing.' And he said to them, 'Why are you afraid, O you of little faith?' Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was great calm. And the men marveled, saying, 'What sort of man is this, that even winds and sea obey him?'" And we're in the Consider Him series right now, and this morning we're going to consider that Jesus was fully man, but next week, and we know that Jesus was fully God also, and that He is able to rebuke the storms. And a lot of times we talk about those trials in our lives as storms that we have to face. But we know God promises to be our strength. Deuteronomy 31:8 says, "The Lord Himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." And we're going to pray through a music video as we conclude the time this morning. It's a video from David Crowder called I Am. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with that or not, but in these last two or three weeks, as we've had several trials around, that song has just really spoken to me. In the middle of the song, it says, "I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am." And I think it's a little bit of play on the words of the great I am, and we're holding on to us, and He's holding on to us as we hold on to Him. One of the times that it spoke the most to me is as we went through the Shuler's time of Rod leaving us from here on this earth, and the testimony that they were holding on to Him and knowing that He was holding on to them. And at the funeral and before that, it was stated and passed on that even though they knew Rod was going to lose that immediately, they also knew, and Rod stated, that the war on his cancer had been won 2,000 years ago. And that is the great I am that we are able to hold on to. We're going to pray in three stages this morning. As we finish, we're going to pray through that video of I Am. And I think our two, first of all, I want to mention, was supposed to mention, that Nancy Russell was not listed in the bulletin. She still is fighting that bacteria. They're making progress on it, but she very definitely needs to be on our prayer list. And we've had some challenges, not only with people and things, but with our technology and our app and everything, and things haven't always been going through. But anyway, she's still on that list, too, and make sure you note her on that list. But as we finish up, what I'm going to ask you to do, if you would, we've done this some different times, but probably our two most imminent prayers right now are Brian's surgery coming up on Wednesday and Norma Lee's continuing treatments in the hospital and hopefully recovery there. Crystal and Max and Mary Sue, representing Raymond and Norma Lee, are going to kind of spread themselves out in the middle of the aisle. And I would ask when we start that song if we would all stand, and as we could, maybe move together, hold hands, and hold on to them too, and symbolically hold on to each other as we lift them up in prayer and know that we are holding on to God and He is holding on to us. First, before we do that, I'd like to take just a couple minutes for each one of us to pray personally. Just take that prayer list that is in front of you. Look through it. The Spirit may lead you to stop on one person and pray for them. It may lead you just to say every one of those names in front of the great I Am who is able to hold on to them. Then I'll go ahead and pray together with us a little bit, and we'll conclude with the song. Let's go to our great I Am in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You this morning that through the sacrifice of Your Son, Jesus, we can come into Your holy presence with our petitions. We thank You that You are the great I Am, that You have promised that You never will leave us nor forsake us, that You will hold on to us through every storm. We just pray that You help us to hold on to You in each and every situation. Help us hold on to each other as we support each other in the power of Your love and prayer, and help those in greatest need to feel not only Your loving arms around them, the most important thing, but help them feel the support of their brothers and sisters in Christ as well. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Go ahead and rise as we continue to worship and praise.
Victory. Oh. Announcements before we just continue on. One of the things that I said when I interviewed here, when Tony on this stage asked me, well, why do you want to come to Griswold? Why do you come to this dinky little town and this little church? And one of the things that I had said was the leadership here. And it hasn't changed. Shut up. they really care about you guys. They really do. So announcements, if you have your bulletin, please take a look at it. There's a ton of stuff going on. Things like Easter is the big thing coming up. And I just want to quickly go over the schedule because it's a little different than it has been in the past. We're going to have a sunrise service very early at 7:45. That'll be in here. The kids are leading that, so it'll be a good time. It's going to be short. Breakfast starts at 8:20, so you can come and get some food, and that'll be really good. And then after that, during the Sunday school hour, instead of having Sunday school, we're going to do a large family Easter egg hunt. So bring your kids, bring grandma, grandpa, and you guys are all going to go out, and there's a small contest that you'll learn about later. So you guys will all want to be on board. And then we'll come in and have a small devotion that leads right into the service. So it's going to be a wonderful day, and everything's going to build upon itself, and it's going to be good. For that, we have a couple of weeks now to get ready for that. At the end of service, you will see students and Garrett handing out these cards. And these are invite cards that you can take with you, take a couple with you. You know, I challenge you to take at least one and give it to somebody that you know isn't going to be anywhere. And invite them to come with you. There'll be some tables out there, too, if everybody's packed up and stuff like that. So grab these on your way out the door. Make sure they make it to your car and then to somebody else. We didn't print them so that you could throw them away. I can do that all by myself. So I don't need your help for that. But I do need your help inviting people. So if you can take one, invite somebody, it's going to be great. And then, you know, it's a great opportunity because Mother's Day is really soon after that as well. So if you know somebody that doesn't have plans and wants to get in on an Easter egg hunt and then come and get churched, there you go. Okay? So other than that, please take a look at all of the announcements in your bulletin because there's lots and lots and lots of things going on. And so as we just continue our worship, let's just remember we have a lot of stuff going on. We truly do. But isn't it great to know that we have a God that is so much bigger and He can handle every bit of it? And so let's all pray, and then we'll get back into worship and pray with me. Father God, I thank you so much for this day, and I just thank you for this church body. I thank you for the leadership here that is seeking after you, God, and wants nothing more but to glorify you. I thank you for the body of people that exist here and how much they do love you and how much they love one another. Father, as we go through these times where, man, there just seems like there's so much going on. There's death and sickness and hurt and pain and fear and anxiety. God, but you bring with it a sense of peace. Father, you bring with it a sense of power and victory because you are that good. You are that powerful and you are that strong. Father, just help us in this time as we move into worship, God. Prepare our hearts to seek after you. Prepare us to learn about the things that you want to reveal about ourselves. God, give us ears to hear and minds to understand and just hearts to feel what you want us to do. Father, I believe you are a big God. I believe you are very real. And I believe that you know us very well. So, Father, we take this time, we set it apart as holy, we set it apart as sacred, so that we will understand who you are. God, minister to us now for all of us that are hurting, for all of us that are broken. God, just reach into our hearts and break us. Bring us before your cross. Bring us before your throne. Let us worship you. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
You can have a seat.
Sure. is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Oh, Jesus, your
morning. For meditation this morning, got a picture that I'd like to put up. Some of you probably figured out I like this picture because I've used it before. Actually, it's a little card that I got that I keep on my desk, and every once in a while I can actually find it when I get it cleaned off. But what I like about it, it's a picture of Jesus holding, could be anybody, but it's you and me. Put yourself in there. You and I have a hammer and a spike in our hands. Jesus has holes in his hands and his feet. The hammer and the spike represent our sin. The holes in Jesus' hands and feet are evidence of his sacrifice for our sins. You can see from the picture that you and I are helpless. Jesus, on the other hand, is alive and well. And I thought it was on that picture, but on my little card, it says forgiven. Jesus has forgiven us. Romans 5:8 says that, but God demonstrated his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. As we prepare for communion, focus on the picture. See yourself being held by those nail-scarred hands, being held by Jesus and forgiven. Let's pray. Precious God and Father, we just thank you for forgiveness. Father God, we know that each and every one of us here today helped drive those nails into Jesus' hands, and it's our sin is the reason that he had to die. And God, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the salvation we can find in that word as it leads us to Jesus. And we, Father, we thank you for that death, burial, and that resurrection. We just pray now that as we partake of the loaf and the cup, that we will remember that broken body, that we'll remember that shed blood, and that without Jesus we'd be lost. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
you'll pray with me. Heavenly Father, this morning as we bring these tithes and offerings before you, we realize that as we studied this morning in Hebrews and Sunday school, that we no longer need a tabernacle, that the veil was torn. We don't no longer need a priest, that Jesus is the great mediator, that he is the one that died for our sins. And this morning, we chose to worship here. We don't longer need a holy of holies. We just thank you for that, for being the one willing to die for us. Pray that you bless both the gift and the giver this morning, that we can spread that word and that we can worship you as you are our Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you want to go to your mustard seeds, you are dismissed, and we will get going. I just wanted to say, first of all, thanks for being here. It's great to be here, and if you're with us online, it's good to see you too. We are live streaming the services now, so, you know, you guys in the back, you have to wake up a little bit now, people can see you. So, but it's great to be here, and God is good, and so I want to just make sure to also just thank the worship team. They don't have Tony lead them. They're doing all this themselves. I didn't pick out any songs. It's all Randy. So Randy and the worship team, let's give them just a thank you. And sound guys, and just, there's a lot of people picking up the slack now that I'm the only one in charge. So we want to make sure to keep Tony in our prayers too as he's down there working. I got a text from him. They said it was a really long first day, but I know they're enjoying their work, and so we just want to keep them in prayer. Before we get started, let's just open this time in prayer. Father God, I thank you so much for today, and I thank you for just how this day began with a prayer and with just gathering around and just loving on your people. God, I see that as the responsibility of the church and the purpose of it, and God, I just thank you to be able to be a part of that. God, as we come to this time of the worship service, I ask that you just preach to us today. God, use me and remove anything that I have put in the way, God, and anything I have missed, please supplement it for me today. Father, we want to hear from you today. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. All right. We have been in this series. We just started a series called Consider Him. That comes out of Hebrews 12:3. If you want to just quick turn there, we're going to read this. We're going to do a lot of jumping around today. So if you have a Bible, get it warmed up. This will be right up your alley. Be able to do some sword drills, Jim. So he was excited Wednesday. So 12:3, Hebrews 12:3, it says, "Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted." This idea of consider him. Who is him? We're talking about Jesus. See, for the last several weeks, we went over a series called Not a Fan. And in that series, we asked the question, are you simply a fan of Jesus, or are you a completely committed follower? And that was a great series, and we got a lot out of it, and we studied it. But I think one of the things that we decided we needed was, in order to answer that question, am I going to be a completely committed follower of Jesus, we must first understand and know who is Jesus. And so as we begin this series, this section of the series, we're going to look at the person of Jesus. Who is Jesus? Why should I follow him? Last week we considered him as a teacher, and this week we're going to look at him as fully man. One of the pillars of our faith is the fact that we believe that Jesus is both 100% man and 100% God. Now some of you guys are like, Willie, I'm not a mathematician, but I'm pretty sure that 100% plus 100% is more percent than there can be in a person. And I'm like, that's correct. However, these are both true and necessary. And so today we're going to look at the part of Jesus that we consider 100% man. And we're going to see why is that necessary. This is one of those topics that can be very thick and can be very scary for some people. But I think it's rather simple. And so today we're going to look at that. There is a show on TV called Undercover Boss. Anybody seen it? Anybody watch it before? For those of you who haven't seen it, this show basically is about these people go into a company, and they go to the owner of the company, one of the managers, one of the people that is high up in the company. And they dress them up, and they send them to one of the lower parts of the company, whether it's a CEO, and they make them go down and be in the mail room, or they send them down to the packaging area, whatever it is. They take these people that earn the big bucks and put them down with the blue-collar guys, and they see how they're going to do. And at the end of that week, they have a review with the owner and the manager, and they bring in the people that he or she worked with. And there's two types of undercover boss shows, and if you've watched the show, you know. There's the first type is the boss that doesn't know what's going on. The guy that just looks at the bottom line, the guy that's out making the money and just is concerned with the financial growth of the company. And they take that guy and they put him down with the people who are all the skilled workers. And usually in that show, what happens is they put on the assembly line, and somebody that's been there for 20 years is packaging stuff and moving stuff right through it, and they're doing a great job. And the manager is there, and he's trying like to put tape on it, and he's looking over, and he can't do the job. And the person that's working there looks at him and is like, what are you doing? And usually it's in a position where they're interviewing to whether they're going to work there. And almost inevitably, those guys get fired. The guys that own the company get fired from the very company they own because they can't do the job. And at the end of the show, they bring them in and they're telling them, listen, you just can't hack it here. You don't know what's going on. You know, maybe you better find someplace else to go. The other type of show, however, is from the guy that has built the company from the ground up. The guy that has worked in every single piece of the company. He worked in the mailroom. He worked in packaging. He drove truck for him. He knows every inch of that company. And that kind of show is more of a show where he goes through and he gets to see the people that are slacking off. He'll go into the mailroom and he knows how to do that job, and he's working and he sees the guys over there taking 20, 30, 40 an hour coffee breaks and sloppily putting on packages and throwing them out or whatever. And this is the kind of show I like to call the eye opener. The show where the guy comes down and realizes there are some people that do not need to be here anymore. And at the end of that week, they reveal the interviewee who they're like, oh yeah, you'll probably do fine. You know, you really don't have to worry about it. The boss never checks up on us. And at the end, he's like, I'm the boss. And you're fired. So there's two types of shows. There's the eye-opener, the need-to-fire show, and the show that reaffirms that perhaps you need to appreciate the little people. Now, imagine this show. If we took this show and we tried to put Bill Gates in this show. Bill Gates, the owner of Microsoft, the man who's worth $59 billion, okay? We tried to take Bill Gates and put him in the show. It would be absolutely ridiculous because, first of all, in order to get him into a company where he wouldn't be known, the disguise that we would have to come up with for Bill Gates would have to be absolutely elaborate. Now, a lot of us in here may not exactly know what Bill Gates looked like. Right now, you're like, I don't know if I'd saw him. But if you work in the tech industry, especially if you work at Windows, you're going to know what Bill Gates looks like. Okay, the richest man in the world. So in order to get him in the company, unknown, we'd have to dress him up in a very elaborate way. Not only that, but while Bill Gates was working, doing whatever job we put him into, the man knows everything about the company. He knows how to code. He knows how to develop. He's been in every aspect of that company that he built. In order for him to pass by as an interviewee, as a person looking to be hired there, he'd have to actually pretend that he didn't know some things, some of the things that only Bill Gates knows. He'd have to dumb it down a little bit. Not only that, but my question, I wonder if he would still get hired in that thing. If people would be either, one, too intimidated by this guy that, well, if I'm in charge and I hire him, he's probably going to take my job. Or if they're like, I don't know, he's kind of a dweeby looking dude. Maybe, you know, I don't think Bill Gates would hire this guy. The thought of Bill Gates being on this show is so ridiculous because of who he is. Because of the person that he is in that company. He is the creator of the internet almost. Understand this. What Jesus has done, what God has done for us, is undercover boss on a cosmic level. God sent his son down in a human form to live among us. And guess what? We fired him. So, Jesus is 100% God and 100% man. So, we're going to look at a couple of things about this. One of the things we need to understand, number one, is Jesus is separate from the Father. He is distinct. Okay? A lot of times we get confused that Jesus is God and they're this thing. The issue is we need to understand that Jesus is separate entity. He is distinct from God. Okay? So if you have the next screen, Philippians 2 is the first place we're going to stop on our journey here. So if you want to turn to me to Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 6. All right, it says this. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Jesus here says that, or Paul says here that Jesus says that equality with God is not something to be grasped. Now the word here in Greek is harpag... Anyway, it doesn't even matter. I could say it, but it doesn't even matter. The Greek word that is translated here for grasped means a claimed or asserted something that is grasped or gripped. Okay? Now, I've seen it translated someplace robbed, where they said that equality with God was not something to be robbed. And I think this is a mistake, because being equal with God is not equal with the act of robbery. You cannot rob anything to be equal with God. In fact, this word is only used one time in the New Testament, and it is only there that we have this understanding of claimed or asserting. So Jesus, in this word, in this phrase, he said that being equal with God, being on the same plane as God, was not something that he was going to claim, that he was going to ascribe or hold on to. And so, we continue reading, but he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. So Jesus here distinguishes himself from God. He in fact says that he is not equal with God as man. He makes himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus himself as a man says he does not claim equality with God. He says in John 17, if we want to jump over real quick, I'll wait. You're going to go to John 17 and right in the first 4 and 5 verses. It says, I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the works that you gave me to do, and now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. Jesus here talks about his divinity with the Father that we'll look at next week, but he talks about now. He says, glorify me as I was with you. He makes himself distinct here, separate, apart from God the Father. If we go to John 1, the very first beginning of the chapter of John, John writes about the creation of the world. He talks about the beginning. And in John 1, 1 through 5, John writes these words. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And in him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. If we continue on in verse 14, it says, and that Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory in the glory as the only Son of God from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, this is he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me. And from his fullness we have received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is the Father's side. He has made him known. John writes about the beginning, and the beginning was this Word. The Greek there is logos, this not just any kind of English, any kind of communication, but something that created, something that had power with just a spoken word would come to existence. That power, that cosmic awesomeness became flesh, and it dwelt among us. It separated, it distinguished itself, and became man. That is Jesus. So understanding that, as we get that, wrap our minds around the fact that we have a Jesus who has distinguished himself from God the Father, who is separate, who is not somehow congealed into one mass, but unique. We say, well, is Jesus then really man? And I think this sometimes, for especially Christians and just believers in general, maybe puts us off a little bit, because I'm a man. And I know other men. And you're saying that my God, the person that we worship, was simply a man. And that's hard for us to understand it and even maybe believe. But we see Jesus' human traits displayed very clearly in the Bible. Mark 4, 38. I'll just jump there real quick. Maybe. There we go. And we read the other passage of this, but it says, there was a great storm that came up, right? We just read that. But Jesus was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him and said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And he awoke, and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Jesus was asleep. You know who else sleeps? Men. And he was asleep on a cushion. Why? Because it was soft. Who wants to sleep on a hard floor? Jesus here demonstrates a very simple act, but it's one of humanity. It's one of humankind. Jesus slept. God does not sleep. Another instance, Luke 4. Luke 4, the beginning in 1 and 2, is right after Jesus' baptism. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness. And for 40 days, being tempted by the devil, he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. Jesus left, and he didn't eat, and he became hungry. He was tempted by the devil. These are human traits. Jesus, the Son of God, came to earth, and he got hungry. He got tired, and he slept. He was tempted. Furthermore, John 11, 35. Shortest verse in the Bible. This was my favorite one in college. My favorite memory verse. Jesus, in 11:35, finds out that Lazarus, one of his friends, is dead. And he goes and he talks to a couple of people. And then in John 11:35, I want to get it right, Jesus wept. Jesus feels sorrow. He mourns the death of a friend, and it says he weeps. And this is not the only time he does this. Right before the triumphal entry, which we're going to celebrate here very soon, Jesus stands outside Jerusalem and looks over it, and it says he weeps over the city because of their wickedness, because of what he knows is about to happen. Jesus, the very Son of God, the Word, the power, the Logos from creation that became flesh, wept over the death of one man. Why? Because he was human. Because when we love somebody, because when we see death, we mourn and we cry. And Jesus was no exception. Another passage in Luke 22, right at the end of Jesus' ministry, right before his betrayal, Jesus goes out into the garden and he asks his disciples to come with him. Luke 22:42. He's praying in the garden and he is anxious about what is about to happen. He knows that he's going to be betrayed by Judas, and he knows that he is moments away from a beating, a scourging, and a death on a cross. And Jesus praying says these words, "Father, if you are willing to remove this cup from me, nevertheless, not my will but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Jesus felt pain. He felt anguish, agony. Jesus sweated and he bled. Those are not characteristics of a God. That's what man does. We get fearful of the unknown. We sweat. We worry about things that are to come. And he bled. He prays to God to take his cup, but submits to his will. Jesus had brothers. Matthew 13, at the end of the chapter 54. He was teaching, and then it says, "And coming to his hometown, he taught there in the synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, 'Where did this man get this wisdom and do these mighty works? Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? Are not his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? Are not all his sisters with us? Where then did this man get all these things?' And they took offense to him. But Jesus said to them, 'A prophet is not without honor except in his own hometown and in his own household.' He did not do many works there because of their unbelief." Jesus grows up for 30 years, known only as a man. The people around him, when he comes home to the place where he grew up and worked with dad and played with brothers and sisters, when he comes home and begins his ministry, they do not understand him. They look at him and say, "Aren't you the guy that I saw? You built that table. You helped Joseph over here. Isn't your mom this person?" They know this guy. For 30 years, they watch Jesus grow up as a man. They give him human qualities. They say, "Aren't you the brother of? Aren't you the son of?" Things that are inherently humankind. Jesus had characteristics, every single one, that you and I do. He was flesh. He hurt. He worried. He played. He bled. Hebrews 4:15 sums up the purpose of this. It gives us a little understanding. Hebrews 4:15. "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Jesus came and he understands what it's like to be human. See, and I think a lot of times we forget that because we talk about Jesus and he was perfect. but he felt every emotion that you and I felt. He felt every struggle. He felt every pain and anxiety that you and I do. Jesus shared with us in humanity. Okay, so we agree. Jesus is man. We can get around that. All right, so what does that mean? That we have a God, we have a man that we worship, who is in fact man. Jesus' humanity shows us not the necessity for sinful men, but rather the potential for humankind as God intended it to be. Think about that for a second. Jesus' humanity, the fact that Jesus was human, shows us not that we have to be sinful, but rather the fact that God had a plan for us as he saw everything that he had made. This is at the end. This is after the beasts are there, the fish, the birds, the trees, and Adam and Eve have been formed out of the very dust of the earth and having God breathed into their nostrils. God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. God made humankind. And because of that, our existence, our potential, our purpose is divinely inspired. And Jesus, through his humanity, shows us this. He gives us a glimpse of what mankind was meant to be. And remember, in the very beginning, we walked with God, and it was very good. Jesus reminds us of this again. He gives us a glimpse many, many years later about what it would be like if humankind, if man, chose to walk with God as opposed to sin. Hebrews 12, jumping back to Hebrews real quick. Why do I keep saying 12? Hebrews 2. Hebrews 2, 17 says this. Therefore, he had to be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become merciful and a faithful high priest in the service of God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. There's a big word in here. And Tony talked about that last week, about how he doesn't like big words, so I thought I ought to break it down before I get in trouble, even though I didn't write it. He says, propitiation, right here again, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of people. Propitiation basically means an atoning sacrifice. And some of you are like, I don't know what atoning means. Super. A forgiving sacrifice. And to break that down even more, the idea of a makeup. How many of you guys have ever had a makeup test? Ever made up a test? How many had the opportunity to make up a test, rather, and then didn't do it, but had it? A makeup test is very simple. You have a test, and either you get sick, something happens, you don't do it when it's supposed to happen. So you get a makeup test. You get to go in and do it at another time. This is what Jesus does for us on the cross. We have sinned, and at another time, Jesus comes, and he makes up for that sin. So because Jesus is man, because he is mankind, he is able to understand and sympathize with us and make that sacrifice. So, as we close up here, the question remains, and I think needs to be answered, what is the implication to us? What does it mean for us if Jesus is not man? If Jesus is only God, which I think some of us, if we had the option, we're like, okay, if Jesus was only man or only God, I would pick only God. Here's the issue. If Jesus, if the one we are here today to worship, if the one that we have built our lives around, that I've dedicated my entire life to, is only man, it means this. One, Jesus cannot be a fitting sacrifice for us, because there is no sacrifice. Sin sacrifices are specific. And if God is only God, if Jesus is not a man, then there is no sacrifice. Because God cannot sympathize with us. God cannot be tempted and overcome sin. And God cannot die. So no matter how many nails they put in his hands, no matter how many times they put him on the cross, God would remain, and there would be no sacrifice. Jesus does not show God's power if he is simply God. He simply shows that he is God. But instead, Jesus, by humbling himself, shows us the very nature of God in the fact that he gives mercy and grace, and that he is there to listen, and that he is there to walk with. It is not impressive for God to be perfect, because God is perfect. But it is far more impressive for a man to be perfect. And for a man to be perfect, for a man to walk as God intended, is in fact divine. There's no compassion, no love, if Jesus is only God. And even worse still, there is no mediation between man and God. 1 Timothy 2:5-6 says this.